Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Of course, you can give that way. You can plunk it in the container on the way out. So how many of you are hungry for the Word of God today? Come on, I'm hungry. We have been in the book of Ephesians. Oh, I just wanted to know if you could. For 3 weeks, we've been in Ephesians. And so guess what chapter we're in today? Chapter 4. Oh, man, you guys are sharp today. Okay. Ephesians chapter 1 talks about what God has already done for us. He has deposited our inheritance in us when we came to Christ. When you receive Christ, God, the Bible says in Ephesians 1:3, that he blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. So God has already deposited into your born-again spirit every spiritual blessing. You know what I'm convinced? I'm convinced the reason that we don't have more blessing in our lives, or God doesn't move in a greater way, is because we just don't understand the process where God takes the blessing, puts it in our life, and how we get it into our life, okay? That's Ephesians 1. Go back and look online. You can find it and listen to it over and over until it gets into your spirit. Ephesians 2, then God looks at us. It's a chapter of us. He talks about where we used to be positioned in the past and where we're now positioned in Christ. And he shows it from God's spiritual perspective. How many of you remember what I said? Our spiritual past is that we were born spiritually dead. Oh, we got a great group today. That's right. And not only that, we were under the rulership of the demonic kingdom. And we were filled with Satan's culture, Satan's way of thinking and desires. When we received Christ, God took us from Satan's kingdom and has given us a new position. Am I right? And we're not just a custodian in the heavenly kingdom. The Bible says we're actually seated with Christ at the right hand of the Father. Ephesians 2:6. God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. This new position that you find yourself in is the place of highest authority in heaven and earth. It's mind-boggling. When Jesus said in Matthew 28, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth, he passed it on to us. In chapter 3, then God speaks, and this I've hit this every Sunday. Chapter 3 was last week. He spoke about our governmental position in the kingdom of heaven. We are ambassadors. We represent God and his kingdom here. When you were made into a new creation, something that had never been seen before, and God gave you the post of the minister of reconciliation, you are on God's cabinet. We are God's representatives here on earth. We have been called to declare and decree the decrees of God over the earth. And let it be made known both to angelic and demonic authorities what God has decreed and what we believe and what will be. That's the authority he gave to us. It's so mind-boggling, we have to have a revelation of it. Now, after Paul spends 3 chapters talking about who you now are, we can call the Bible the mirror of God because it shows you who you really are. But now in chapter 4, thank God, now he tells us, based on all of this, how do I walk this out on the planet, okay? How do I live this life? And so here it is. Now that we know who we are, now we know what authority has been given us, how do we walk on this earth? And this is so important because we see every day in life people who have great fame, great power, and great money, and how it turns them into arrogant snobs. Okay, am I right? Get a little money, little power. I had a guy that worked with me. We had the same position. We were the lowest. When we went home from Russia and we worked in the church in Michigan, we were designated intern pastors, and there was another guy with me. But so there was a Wednesday night when no one was there, and I was supposed to preach that night for this large church, 14,000 people there. And the other guy that was my friend, co-worker, he was placed in charge of the behind-the-scenes stuff. And just as I was about to get up to preach, he took me in the back, and he began to yell at me. And I thought, what, what? He said, I know that you've already talked with the worship leader about how to change the worship, some of the songs so it'd match your message. I told him to forget everything you told him. You're going to do it this way, this way, this way. And I thought, what happened? This guy is my coworker. We talk together every day, but now they gave him a little power and he just kind of beaten me with it. You know, has that ever happened to you? So now that God has given you all authority in heaven and earth, where demons quake, and we are to be his representative. How do we walk it out? Are we going to become arrogant snobs? No. This is important. Ephesians 4:1. Therefore, Paul is saying, I, the prisoner of the Lord, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of that calling which you've been called to. So what is it? How do I walk now as a child of God, the son of the king? How do I walk with that authority? Are you ready for this? Verse 2, be completely humble, gentle, patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every opportunity or make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Wow. Now that God has given us all authority in heaven and earth, what does he say? Be humble, be gentle, be patient, bear with one another in love. Keep the unity of the Spirit. See, Jesus is so clear. We don't wield authority like the pagans do. Mark 10, Jesus called his disciples together, had to explain it to them, and he said this. You know that those who were regarded as rulers over the Gentiles, they lorded over them. Their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. Slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Notice the heart of our King. John 13. This scripture just blows me away. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, that he had come from God and was returning to God. He got up from his meal, took off his outer clothing, wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet. There's a revelation that we need. Spirit of God, I ask that you fall upon your people, that we would see this, oh God. Notice, this is a fill in the blank. We are servant kings in God's kingdom. We emulate our master, the Lord Jesus Christ, who knowing all things were put under his power, he took off his outer clothing and washed his disciples' feet. We are servant kings. In fact, God goes on to explain his goal for us. His goal for us in this lifetime. Ephesians 4:13. Until we all reach unity in the faith, reach the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. God's goal for you is not to just to barely swim in the sea of sin and keep your head above the water. No. God's goal for you is that you reach unity. We reach unity in the faith, that we reach a knowledge of the Son of God, and we become mature. That word actually is perfect. They don't like to say that. And become perfect, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. I love how the Phillips translation says it. Thank you. We're not meant to remain as children at the mercy of every chance wind of teaching and the jockeying of men who are expert in the craft presentation of lies. But we're meant to hold firmly to the truth and love and to grow up in every way into Christ, the head. Here's another fill in the blank. We are to grow up into Christ. What does that mean? We are to become like him. Like him. I'm going to blow you away because, you know, the more people, the more money people have, the more power people have, they wield it. Am I right? Do you know why God resists the proud and gives mercy and grace to the humble? Because God has a humble heart. He's not an arrogant ruler. And he can't relate to proud people. He can't relate to them. See, you want to know who's proud? Satan was lifted up in pride. Satan was lifted up in pride. Every time we get proud, we are emulating Satan. We are to grow up into Christ. We are to become like him. You know, that's what the word Christian means. Christian means like Christ. So how do we walk on earth like Christ? Well, this is the message of Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4:17. So I say this, I affirm this in the Lord, that you no longer walk just as the Gentiles walk. See, because of who we are, we're not supposed to walk like the rest of the world. Did you hear me? We're not supposed to live. We're not supposed to walk like everyone else. We're supposed to walk differently. Do you know what bothers me about this? When companies poll Christians and they write statistics about us, They say there is no difference in the way we live compared to the world around us. Our divorce rate, the amount we watch TV, the amount we surf the internet, the movies we watch. They say that there is no difference from the way we walk and the way the world walks. That ought to slap us all in the face. Is there a great disconnect between what God wants for us and how we live? I think so. How do we actually walk differently from those around us who's not been touched by Jesus? Because that's the message of Ephesians 4:17 says this. You must no longer walk as the Gentiles or the pagans do, in the futility of their thinking. They're darkened in their understanding. They're separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Here's a fill in the blank. God tells us what the long-term consequences of being spiritually dead is. Our hearts harden, our understanding darkens, our thinking and our worldview are affected. When we come to Christ, when we see the light, when we're born again, I'm telling you, we already have a hard heart. Our thinking and understanding is darkened, and our whole worldview is the same worldview that Satan has. So when we receive Christ, the first thing God asks us to do is to renew, be transformed by the renewing of our thinking. Hello? Am I talking to anybody today? So now that the life of God is in you, and you obey him by meditating on his word day and night, it should change the way you think, and that should change the way you live. Amen. Don't think I'm going to get a lot of amens. Well, let me give you a few steps, because I love to look at steps are real easy for us. This is what we call Ephesians for Dummies, all right? So we got steps here. No, I just say that because it's easier for us to work on steps here. So let me give you a few steps, because in Ephesians 4, he tells us how to bring lasting change into our behavior, how we actually live. Step one, transform your thinking by meditating on God's word day and night. If you fill your heart and mind with television and internet for hours a day, and you read 10 minutes or 5 minutes of God's word each day, do not expect God's word to transform your life. Just saying. Romans 12:2, do not conform to the pattern of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Or as Ephesians 4 says it, you were taught with regard to your former way of life. Notice what he says, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds. So the reason why Paul spent 3 chapters telling you who you are now in Christ is so that you would think differently and see yourself differently. So now Paul tells us the second step. Ephesians 4:22, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self. Step two, put off your old self. See, when you receive Christ, something happens to you that has never happened before. Because when you now, after you receive Christ, and now you sin or do wrong, something inside feels bad. Am I right? You're convicted. You feel heavy. It's like carrying around a weight inside. That which was joyful before, man, there's something. It's not as fun as before. What happened? Holy Spirit's in you. So when you receive Christ, he begins to convict you of sin, and that moves you to stop it. One of the missionaries we worked with in Russia, his name was Tom Helbig. Tom and Mary, they worked with us for several years in Russia. He shared his story with me. When he was 18 or 19, he some sort of robbery, got thrown in prison. And he said to himself, I'm never coming back here again. While he was in prison, he got saved, barely saved. His parole officer kind of helped disciple him. He said, our first discipleships were real intense. I had a beer in one hand, a cigarette in another, and we were just reading the Bible. He said, but how many of you know that when you come to Christ, there are a few things out of order in your life? I joke about smoking and drinking, but I'm just saying there are a few things out of order, sin issues and other things. Am I right? And I know the first thing that happened to me when I received Christ is when I started doing things I used to do, the Holy Spirit put his finger on them. Well, they didn't feel as fun before, and I could feel him inside saying, don't do that. He put finger on some people in my life. Don't spend time with them. They're going to destroy you. Am I right? So there's two things in our life. Here's a fill in the blank that the Spirit moves on us to get rid of. Sins and weights. When you receive Christ, you lose your desire for sin almost overnight. But there are still many weights in our life. If you're running a race, how many of you know you want to be as thin as possible? If you ever see horse races, the jockeys, they're like 89 pounds. You know what I'm talking about? Because they try to have the smallest, skinniest little guys on the planet. And so if you're a midget, those are the best jockeys on the planet. They want very light weight because you can't win a race with lots of weight. However, we are burdened down with many weights in our life. They're not sins, but they're weights. They stop you from fulfilling God's purpose in your life. And so God puts his finger on our sins, and then he starts putting his finger on our weights. When I received Christ, I was 11. And I remember, yeah, that was quite a while, just a few years ago, right? And but I remember, he began putting his finger on things. They weren't sin, but the amount of hours I watched TV, the amount of books I read a week, I would read five fiction novels a week. I love to read. And he began to put his finger on them because they were weights in my life. I would never fulfill his purpose if I spent all my time doing this, this, and this. Do you hear me? And if God has never put a finger on something in your life, you're not born again. You need to be saved, okay? Just saying. Because there comes a time in our Christian walk that most of our sins and our weights, they've left us because the Holy Spirit's been working on us for years. And if he doesn't, we have the second Holy Spirit, guys, right? Our wife, that she works on us too. Am I right, Todd? Aren't we so blessed to have two Holy Spirits in our life? Amen. Sometimes we don't listen to the Holy Spirit, the first Holy Spirit, so we need that second one, right? I'm just saying. Anyway, trust me, I nag her more than she nags me. Because, you know, there's always, it works both ways. Am I right, honey? Yeah, that's why the Bible says iron sharpens iron. Am I right? How many of you married some iron? Oh, good for you. Okay. So in Ephesians 4, Paul tells us how to use God's power to be set free from those things. So let me just say this. Let's say you're here today, you're born again, but there's still a sin issue that you still haven't been able to get free from. And that's about everybody. Am I right? We get rid of most of our sins, most of our weights, use that first year of Christ. But there's usually something we hang on to, we baby it, we say, you know, it's just a small thing. Surely God can overlook this one, right? And yet you know it's something that you shouldn't do. Let me just give an example. I could give you a list. But let's just say your issue is anger and yelling, okay? You know, part of the problem is most of our sin issues were passed down to us by our parents. How many of you know that you didn't know you were a yeller until you got married? Say, you yell all the time. Well, I'm just like my dad. Yes, that's the problem. Am I right? So when the Bible says to put off your old self, it means in the morning before you have a chance to get angry and yell, you open your mouth and you say this, today I'm putting off yelling and anger. And I'm not going to get mad and I'm not going to yell at anyone. I won't get angry on the road or at my house. We speak in, I'm just saying, that's how you put it off. You do it in faith. You believe in your heart, you speak with your mouth. You hear me? It could be something else. Could be anything, but I'm just using that as an example. We put off the old self, here's a fill in the blank, in faith, which means we speak what we believe in our heart. I shared a couple years ago, Pastor Jimmy Evans, a great pastor out of Amarillo, Texas. When he was a teenager, before he was a Christian, he got hooked on smoking. And he had very adept at smoking. He smoked two packs a day. When he received Christ, he tried and he tried and he tried to quit smoking. I'm not saying smoking is sin, but it sure is a weight. It sure is a weight in life. And if you don't believe me, that's okay. But I'll tell you what, you won't live long enough to fulfill your purpose if you smoke all the time. That's all I'm saying. And when people look at you, they're going to say, well, you can't possibly be a Christian because people don't believe Christians smoke. So I'm just saying it's a weight. But anyway, he wanted to get rid of smoking, but he couldn't, okay? This was before all the nicotine gum and all the patches and other things. He was a chain smoker, and he worked at an appliance store, and he went with a guy, and they would drop off appliances all day in a truck together. The guy drove, smoked, he smoked. So he said, God, I need you to help me to stop smoking. What do I need to do? He said, well, break all your cigarettes. And from this day forward, you need to tell, when anyone says anything, if you want to smoke or something, you say, I'm a non-smoker. You're making a faith confession. You're speaking out of faith. So the next day, they get in the truck together. He shares the story. The guy says, hey, I see you don't have a cigarette. You want one of mine? And Jimmy looked at him. He said, no, I'm a non-smoker. And the guy looked at him, I am sure that you smoked 2 packs just yesterday. How are you a non-smoker? Am I right? But I want you to know that when he spoke that, a strength and a power came to him, and he went through that whole day without smoking. Every time he had the urge, he said out loud, I'm a non-smoker. What was he doing? He was putting off. You got to put off the old self. Got to put off the old self. We do that in faith. Step 3, ask God for help. Help! Then when we go to God, we tell him that without his help, we won't be able to stop getting angry and yelling at people. Step 4, put on the new self. Ephesians 4, 22 to 23 gives us the process. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. To be made new in the attitude of your mind. There's the meditating part on the word. Then put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. So we see the steps here. We put off the old self. We get the new attitude in our mind. We met by meditating on God's word. Then we put on the new self. There are 2 important things to see here. When we put off the sin or the weight from our life, that's the first important step, but by itself it's incomplete. So many times we just try to stop something, but we have to replace it with something else. If we just take off the old habit, it leaves a void in us. It's just like when you go, how many of you have ever gone to a clothing store and tried on clothing? Am I right? Okay. So everybody here, I'm sure you've done that. My wife has a unique way of doing it. She buys clothes, she will never try them on. Am I right? And it's boring, she says. Of course, we always have to go back and take back clothes. How many of you know it doesn't look right? Anyway, but here's the thing. But when you go to the clothing store, guys, and you got to put on a new pair of pants, what do you have to do first? Thank you. You got to take out the old. Am I right? You don't put a new pair of pants over the old pair of pants. Does somebody do that? No, listen, that's not how that works. You take off the old shirt, you put on the new shirt. Am I right? So when you have to take off the old to put on the new, okay? That's right. So when we receive Christ, the Spirit of God in us puts his finger, this is a fill in the blank, he puts his finger on the habits, the sins, and the lifestyles that we need to put off. He'll put his finger on them. Am I right? So then we ask for God's help. Then we have to form godly habits. Notice what Paul says in Ephesians 4. Therefore, each of you, I want you to catch this. I want you to look for the put off, put on. Each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor. What's he telling us to do? Stop lying, put it off, and put on speaking truthfully. Then he goes on, anyone who's been stealing, steal no longer. Work, doing something useful with your hands. What's the put off? You put off stealing, you put on working. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only that which is helpful to building others up according to their needs. What do we put off? Unwholesome talk. What do we put on? Talk that builds up other people. As a child of God, as an ambassador of the kingdom of God, you do not have the right or authority to put down people with your words. God has commanded us that we may only bless and build up people with your mouth. Give you a great example with your children. You have 2 choices. You can tell your children what a little son of Satan he is. Am I right? Why, you little snot, you're never going to get any better in your life. Am I right? How many of you had a parent like that? Or you can say, son, you are too good a person to act like that, and I'm not going to let you act like that anymore because that's not who you are. How we speak is life or death to people. So God tells us in these scriptures what to put off and then what to put on. Am I right? In chapter 4, Paul emphasizes 2 strongholds. There's 2 strongholds here. Tell me what time it is. Okay, we're good. Woo! Man, I'm ahead of schedule. Whoa, we're going to be gone before we know it. Woo! Anyway, so he tells us there are 2 stronghold issues in people's lives. And so after he tells us to put off, put on, he deals with 2 strongholds in our lives. Let's see if that's a stronghold in you. Anger and your words. Your attitude and your mouth. Anybody relating here? Okay. Verse 25, speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. Notice. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. Do not give the devil a foothold. So here's what he's saying. When we have issues with other people, God said it's okay to be angry as long as you don't sin when you're angry. See, let me say what anger is. People don't understand that, because I remember someone telling me, well, God is really not really a great God, because the Bible says that he got angry. No, anger means, and anger, God puts anger in us. It is an innate indicator that your boundaries have been violated. And when you're angry, it's like a Popeye moment. That's all I can stand. I can't stand no more. Am I right? Olive oil's tied to the train tracks, you know, and the train's coming. And then, you know, Bluto's just beat the snot out of him. Am I right? So his boundaries have been violated. When you get angry, that is, so, you know, many of us, we're very patient people or lazy people. When terrible things happen to us, we don't react. If it had not been for anger, we would still be doing the things we used to do. But anger tells us, hey, my boundaries have been violated. I need to do something. Anger is our cue. Hey, you need to do something. Unfortunately, our culture has taken anger and has added nuclear bombs to it. And now we have an angry, sinful, angry culture. But Bible, the anger itself is not sin. It tells us that a boundary has been crossed. Okay? So when we're angry, God tells us what to do. He said, don't let the sun go down on your anger. So two things happen. Here's a fill in the blank when we don't deal with anger on the same day. Two things. Your heart gets hard towards that person. And when you go to bed with anger, you give Satan the legal right to accuse that person in your mind. That's why God tells us we have to resolve anger on a daily basis. He never made us with the capacity to carry anger long term. If you go to bed angry at your spouse and you don't resolve it, you will wake up with a hard heart towards them. If you resolve the anger, you wake up with your love renewed. You know, it's interesting when couples come in for marriage counseling, they're both convinced that the other is a terrible person. How did they arrive at that conclusion? I'll tell you what happened. You can boil it down to one thing. They went to bed angry, and that night Satan accused them, their spouse to them, and they have lived for days, weeks, months and years with Satan accusing, because they gave them the legal right by not resolving their anger, giving Satan the legal right to accuse their spouse in their mind. So when they go to counseling, they have a list of things that Satan gave them about the other person. Hello? And you know what the second, so don't go to bed angry. Resolve it. And your heart will always stay soft towards the other. So what's the second issue people have? With unresolved anger, guess what? When they're angry, they say terrible things about each other. Shock, surprise. Ephesians 4:29, God's going to tell us what to do. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of our mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. So I want you to catch this. Right after the Bible talks about anger, it talks about your words. And then the next verse, it talks about your words can grieve the Holy Spirit. You don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit. You need him. What grieves the Holy Spirit is when you treat people as if they're not as important as they really are. God loves people. He considers all people precious. If you want to hurt God, here's how you do it. You speak unhealthy words to other people. Verse 31, get rid of bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Now that verse says it all. It talks about three levels of anger and three levels of destructive communication. So there are three levels of anger that God says to get rid of: bitterness, rage, and anger. So the first level of anger is anger. That's the emotion of indignation and anger. God tells us to be honest about our anger. Get rid of it the same day. Bitterness is anger that has aged inside you. You never got rid of it. You never resolved it. And anger that stays inside you becomes bitterness. If you see a bitter person, if you know a bitter person, if you are a bitter person, you have allowed anger to live in you for ages, and it has changed you. It is aged anger. And then rage. Rage, violent people store up so much anger that it makes them violent. Rage is a violence. That's the third level. Anger, if it's not dealt with, guess what? It moves to that aged anger, becomes bitterness. You keep bitterness long enough, it will return to rage. You have stored up so much anger that has made you violent. Those three types of anger now lead to three types of communication. Brawling. Brawling is yelling or shouting. Volume. So every time you see the word brawling, you need to think the word volume. That's the first warning sign that you have unresolved anger. When you can't talk at a normal tone of voice to somebody. Hello? The warning sign of brawling is volume. So we don't use volume to communicate anger, because volume equals violence. Don't use volume with kids. It only in emergencies, because volume is impersonal, it's violent. If you have to use volume to control your children, you don't have control. You need to get close to them, quietly talk to them, put your arm around them, because you have a relationship with them. Do you know that God doesn't use volume when he talks to us? It's always his still small voice. Because I think that if he used his real voice on some of us, if he used volume like we did, we wouldn't have eardrums. We really wouldn't. I believe that. So the first type of godless communication is brawling, yelling or shouting. That is the sinful reaction to anger that has not been resolved. The second one is slander. Slander, and that's damaging speech that misrepresents the nature of another person. We call that name calling. So the warning sign of slander is venom. Your anger, you've held it so long, it's venomous, and you can't talk to them normally without calling them names. Calling them names. You idiot, you jerk, you this, you that. Hello? That's slander. And the worst one of all is malice. Malice is wicked speech that is designed to injure and is not ashamed to break all the rules. You know how you know you have malice? When you get mad, you want to get even. You want them to feel that you want them to feel your pain. When she gets mad, she calls me every name in the book. I don't know if I can forgive her for what she said. I hear this all the time. Because they have a torch and burn policy. They say the worst things they can because they just want to hurt you with their words. That is godless speech. That is malice. So what does God say? Take off. Go back to that scripture. Take off. Get rid of bitterness, rage, and anger. See, rage, and bitterness. When you don't resolve anger, that's what happens. You get bitterness or rage, and then it leads to brawling, slander, and malice. Yeah. Let me share one more interesting scripture, and then we're going to pray. Proverbs 18:21, the tongue has the power of life and death. You know, we know that scripture, but it's in context. Those who love it will eat its fruit. He who finds a wife finds what is good, receives favor from the Lord. Isn't that interesting? When it talks about marriage, it talks about your mouth. God puts marriage right after death and life or in the power of the tongue. Why? Because in your marriage, in your relationships, your mouth will either bring life to your relationship or it will bring death. And Satan, he tries to poison our spouses so that instead of giving us life-giving communication, they give us bitter, venomous, slander, violent, malice, and death with their words. I want you to know that spouses have the ability to damage us deeper than anyone else on the planet. And that's the truth. And I believe the reason we're here today, because the Holy Spirit is here. He's here to heal damaged hearts, emotions, and relationships. And sometimes we just think it's normal because that's how we've always seen other people react. It's not normal. Not in the kingdom, it isn't. Not in our kingdom. In Satan's kingdom, it's rampant. But Jesus said, he sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. To bind up the brokenhearted. I'll tell you what breaks our hearts. When we treat one another like dirt, when we say venomous, slanderous speech, rage, bitterness. I'm telling you, God wants, it's like when you have a wound that's got a lot of pus in it, we need to get the pus out. Only the Holy Spirit can get that pus out. He's here to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim captive or freedom to the captives, to release from darkness the prisoners, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who grieve, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Today there is a presence of the Holy Spirit that wants to heal your heart, heal your relationship. It starts with repentance. Oh God, forgive me for the words I've said. Oh God, forgive me for the things I've done. Forgive me for allowing my anger to rage for days instead of resolving it before the night was over. Step one. Step two, Spirit of God, heal me of it. Heal me. Make me like you. I don't want to be like this anymore. I'm going to put off my bitterness. I'm going to put off my rage. I'm going to put off my anger. I'm going to put off my brawling. I'm going to put off my slander. I'm going to put off my malice. And God, I need your help today. Oh God, help me, because I don't want to be like this anymore. I don't want to be like my father. I don't want to be like my mother. I don't want to be like the people around me. I want to be like you, Jesus. Put off the old man. put on the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the command of God for his children today. Let's stand in the presence of God. Hallelujah. I'm talking to you today. I don't care who you are. There is an anointing here for that. There's an anointing here for healing, for breaking of old bondages, for breaking of hatreds and bitterness. There's an anointing. And I'm going to ask everyone that can, if you've got something in your life, probably even passed down to you, I want you to come forward as our worship team. We're gonna sing one song, but I there's an anointing here. I want our prayer team to come forward. We just want to lay hands on you. We want to bring the anointing to you to give you the power to say no, the power to break it off. But let's pray one prayer first. I want everyone to pray this out loud. Dear God, I repent for allowing anger to stay in my life, for the sinful ways I've expressed anger to people. I repent of my words, my slanderous words, my brawling words, and malice that I've let in my heart. Make me like you today. I take those off right now. Help me, Holy Spirit, to live like Jesus. Amen. Spirit of God, fall on every person here. Hey, we're going to sing. As we sing, if you've got an issue, if you feel that heaviness, if you feel the Holy Spirit putting his finger on you, please come forward. If I wasn't preaching, I'd come forward, okay? So I'm just saying, come on. Let's let the anointing touch us today. Let's go out different people today. Amen. So let's worship.